Okay, so what is nuclear medicine? Nuclear, by the word, means it deals with radioactive substances. But why it's not called nuclear diagnostics? Why nuclear medicine? Because unlike the other diagnostic branches, it also deals with therapy. So how did this branch come into existence? It all started with a therapy ward which was built in Mumbai in around 1964. So it actually started with therapy. This department actually started with therapy to deal with the treating patients rather than the diagnostic aspect of this branch. So now in around 1982, NBE, National Board of Examination, recognized nuclear medicine as a broad specialty. And the first MD started in SGPGL Lucknow, which was the first MD in Asia and India in 1990. As of the date of 2018, there are 293 nuclear medicine departments, which include 233 gamma cameras, 222 PET CT centers, and 92 wards with around 200 beds. But keep in mind, this is data of 2018, and I'm going to share with you very soon what's the current trend. The hospitals which offer these courses, MD, ND, NB, will be shown to you on the next slide. So here you go. You can pause to take a screenshot, or we'll continue with the next segment. Hype for nuclear medicine was always there, but now with many centers getting their PET CT machine, the demand for nuclear medicine physician is an all-time high. In the previous segment, I told what was the statistics of PET CT and gamma camera centers in 2018. Now you'll see what's the rising trend. As you see from this graph, it is pretty obvious how the PET CT centers and gamma camera centers are increasing. The PET CT is represented by the blue line, and the SPECT is represented by the gray line. In 2018 and 19, you can see there were around only 200 and 140 PET and SPECT respectively. In 2023, the number has almost doubled, with 437 PET centers and 247 SPECT centers. I'm expecting to see an even further increase, and obviously the demand will be high because only 40 nuclear medicine physicians are graduated per year. USA and Japan have around 4 PET scanners per million population. For India to even have a realistic ratio of 1.0, it needs to add around 1,000 more PET CT centers. Doctors are getting to know this, and just like the field of radiology, how it was 20 years back, nuclear medicine is also experiencing a similar kind of gain. Learning is divided actually into three main postings, the first being the gamma camera, second being the PET CT, and third, the therapy. In next years, like in second and third year, you also get a periphery radiology posting where you'll learn about the basic CT anatomy, ultrasound for thyroid, MRI, and the basic aspects of radiology. Because all these are integrated in nuclear medicine because of hybrid technologies in this department, which are PET and CT, PET MRI, SPECT CT. In thyroid, you'll be using ultrasounds to see the thyroid gland. So all these modalities are important in this department. Coming to the first posting, gamma camera or SPECT. What do we do actually? We answer a lot of questions which the physician wants to know based on physiology and pathophysiology. Some of the questions being if a child has antenatal hydronephrosis, thus, is the kidney obstructed or not obstructed? Is there any stress-induced ischemia if the patient has a heart disease? Can he undergo a long surgical procedure? Will his heart be able to withstand the stress? Are there any metastases in bones because of breast cancer, prostate cancer? Or is the pain in bone due to an infection in the bone causing osteomyelitis, or is it due to cellulitis? What is the baseline perfusion of the brain prior to revascularization? For Moyamoya disease, has recurrent UTI resulted in renal scars? And there are so many more questions which we can answer using SPECT cameras. You would have heard of many scans like bone scan, HIDA scan, EC scan, myocardial perfusion scan, DMSA scan. All of these scans are done in this department in SPECT posting. The next posting is PET, positron emission tomography. Here we deal with radiopharmaceuticals which emit positron during their decay process, which is used by these cameras to image various things, but the majority being oncology or cancers. One of the common radiopharmaceuticals which I use in this posting is 18F-FDG. There are many other pharmaceuticals which we use and are upcoming, like DOTA, DOTANOC, and various others. But the main pharmaceutical which we'll use in almost day-to-day life will be the MDG. This pharmaceutical is a marker for metabolism, glucose metabolism. And using this marker, we are able to tell what is the metastasis position or the metastasis evaluation of the cancer. This is used for baseline as well as treatment response evaluation. Apart from cancers, there are many other things like dementia and metabolism markers of various diseases and so many more. The branch is actually growing, and every year some new radiopharmaceutical and marker comes, and we nuclear physicians experiment on them to notice or to find out if they can be implemented in new protocols and patient management. The last and the most interesting posting, the therapy. In this, you feel like you're an active treating physician or a clinician. You take part in patient management. You take part in OPDs, deal with patients' problems, and do the radiopharmaceutical or nuclear therapy on those patients. Majority of the patients come with thyroid problems like post-thyroidectomy or Graves' disease, where you do radioiodine ablation. But the newer modalities are always coming up, which include lutetium therapy, yttrium therapy, radiation synovectomy, so many more. And the field is always growing, and it becomes a very interesting part. Apart from the huge investigative aspect, the diagnostic, the therapeutic aspect is also growing, which makes this field a lot more interesting. The beauty of nuclear medicine is that the detectors are able to detect very minute, even nanomolar concentrations of the radiopharmaceutical which we inject. So this helps us to even inject very low doses of the drug in the patient to do the test, which means the radiation exposure to the patient as well as the physician is very minimal. Apart from that, there are strict guidelines on how to do radiation safety in the department, and all the working staff have to wear some badges known as TLD, which monitor the radiation exposure to the physician and the treating staff. These badges are monitored regularly to see what is the radiation exposure that the person is getting. And if the radiation exposure is more, which rarely ever happens, the person will be shifted to a place where he is not exposed to radiation. For example, only a reporting room or some other area where he does not have to deal with radiopharmaceuticals. That being said, the radiation exposure usually happens only in the first 3 years of GRSHIP. After that, it's usually reporting. And if you are interested in therapy, then the radiation exposure will always be there. But after GRSHIP, the radiation exposure is almost zero. Okay, coming to the big elephant in the room. Is your job secure after doing this post-graduation degree? Short answer, yes. But why do I say so? We have already seen the trend of the nuclear medicine centers, and it can be said with a fair confidence that it will keep on increasing. And by rule, it is mandatory for a nuclear medicine physician to be there in the center for the center to work. Without a nuclear medicine physician, that center cannot be even established or be functional. So the point is that your job is definitely secured, as the number of seats are limited and the PET-CT centers are increasing. The demand is so high, but the supply is too low, and I can expect this to be the same for a few more years. who should take this branch? First, we should understand this branch is an amalgamation of all pure science streams: biology, physics, chemistry, and of course, mathematics. People who are interested in all those pure science streams should definitely have an interest in this nuclear medicine department. Apart from that, this department is not only for investigations, but also for therapy. So people who don't want to leave the therapeutic or the clinician aspect of their life can definitely think about this branch. Apart from that, people usually take this branch thinking that it is a way of getting a better work-life balance. And yes, the statement is true. The work and life has a very good integration in this branch. The work hours are limited, the environment is friendly, people are friendly, and obviously the stress is minimal. Signing off.